So today we'll discuss about unrestricted grammar. So already we know that what is meant by grammar. The grammar which contains terminals, non-terminals, input symbols and production rules. So every grammar is having like that only. Here we said that the grammar is unrestricted. So if the left hand side and right hand side both are having the combination of terminals and non-terminals. So when you observed any production rule, so generally, so earlier we discussed the production rules which contains, so left hand side only non-terminals are there and right hand side you may contain terminals and non-terminals. But unrestricted grammar contain both left hand side and right hand side, it may contain, there is a possibility to get terminals and non-terminals also. Means generally non-terminals are represented with capital letters and terminals are represented with small letters. So when you observe any production rule, the left hand side also you may contain terminals and non-terminals. Mean it will be like this. So it may contain like some, for example, some capital A tends to some SK. It is general production rule which we have in general normal grammar. So unrestricted grammar, it may contain small a tends to SA like this. So it may contain terminals and non-terminals also. So in that case, we call it as a unrestricted grammar. And not only this one, it may contain the combination also. Means it may having like some, for example, SA tends to AB, B. So this is also, it comes under unrestricted grammar. So this is about unrestricted grammar. Here we are saying that, so left hand side, it belongs to VN union sigma whole star. Means VN means non-terminals, sigma means terminals. So both the combination. And similarly, right hand side also, it contains terminals and non-terminals. So this is about unrestricted grammar. So next, properties of recursive and recursively enumerable languages. So generally, when you call properties, it may contain union, intersection, like that only. So here also, we are having similar. So the properties of recursive and recursively enumerable languages are, the first one is union. So the union of two recursive languages is recursive. So recursive language is nothing but it is the language itself is having continuously calling, recursion process. So if the two recursive languages, if you applied union, there is a chance to get recursive language itself. And the union of two recursively enumerable languages. So recursively enumerable languages also we get recursively enumerable. Similarly, intersection. So intersection of two recursively languages are recursive. So intersection of two recursively enumerable languages also recursively enumerable. Similarly, complement also. So complement is also one of the property of recursively enumerable languages and recursive languages. Okay. And concatenation. The concatenation of two recursively enumerable languages is recursively enumerable. And concatenation of two recursively languages is also recursive. And having the property of clean star means we may call it as a clean closure also. So the clean star operation on a recursively enumerable language is recursively enumerable. So same clean star for recursive language also. And intersection. So the intersection of recursively and recursively enumerable languages is recursively enumerable. The intersection of recursive and recursively enumerable languages. If you have done intersection of one recursive language and one recursively enumerable language, then result will be recursively enumerable. Okay. So, if you assume that the language is recursive language, then sigma star minus L is also recursive. Means the subtraction of the language from the input symbols is also recursive. So, next one is undecidability. So, generally, we can divide the theory of computation problems into two types, decidable and undecidable. So, decidable problems are nothing but the problems which is having solution. The problems which are having solution, we call it as a decidable problem. Means, there is a chance to find the solution with the help of either finite automata or pushdown automata or else Turing machine. So, if the problem doesn't have any solution, means there is no possibility to find the solution with the help of computer, we call it as a undecidable problem. So, we don't have any solution. So, it is highly impossible to find the solution to that problem. Then we call it as a undecidable problem or undecidability. Next, decidable or solvable. So, decidable is nothing but if there exists a Turing machine for a particular language, then we call it as a decidable problem. And solvable means same similarly. And recognizable. So, recognizable also similarly we call it as a solvable only. And undecidable. So, just now we discussed what is meant by undecidability. So, if you didn't find any solution to the problem, then we call it as a undecidable problem. Next, reducibility is there. So, reducibility is nothing but, so just now we discussed that about undecidable problem. So, undecidable problem is nothing but we don't have solution. So, it is highly impossible to find the solution to that problem. So, we can't solve that one. So, in that situation, we consider reducibility. So, reducibility is nothing but, here what we are doing is, we can find one problem and we'll try to find the solution to that problem. So, if we take one problem, initially we may say that is undecidable. So, if we find that problem, so if we get the solution, then based on that solution, we can find another problem which is undecidable. That is reducibility. Here, the definition itself is saying that a reduction is a process of converting one problem into another solved problem in such a way that the solution of the second problem can be used to solve the first problem. So, if you take two problems, so we'll find the solution to the second problem. So, if you find the solution to the second problem, based on that solution, there is a possibility to solve the first one, which is undecidable. Simply, we can say that, so, if I assume that in court cases, so, if you find one case which is highly impossible to solve it, so, then in that situation, so, they will find the similar cases which is already solved. So, based on that consideration, automatically, this case also solved. That is called reducibility. So, if you find the problem solution, and if the now problem is I don't have any solution, but based on similar problem, if I say solved, similar problem, it is not same problem, like that only. If I found the solution which is having like that, then that solution will be applied to this problem. That is called reducibility. Next, post-correspondence problem. So, this post-correspondence problem is used for undecidability problems. So this PCP, we may call it as a PCP also, is very useful for showing the undecidability of many other problems by the means of reducibility. So, we'll find the solution for one. Based on that, we'll go to another one. So, it is a simple problem which here we are having. Assume it, I am having some five cards. Here, the post-correspondence problem will be divided like cards only. So each card contains two parts, top and bottom. So it may having some input on top side and it may having some input in bottom side. So when you observe here in this example, I am having totally five cards. The first card is having input 010. Second card is having input 011 and 00. Third card is having 011. Fourth card is having 0110. And other card is having 111. So the post correspondence problem here, what we are doing is we'll find same string on upper bound and lower bound. So means on top side and bottom side. When you combined these five cards, the string of upper side and the string of downside both should contain same. So that is the solution we need to find. So with the help of these five cards, interchanging, we can find the solution. But here we are not discussing regarding these all things. So manually we need to interchange it, we need to check it, and finally we supposed to mention the result. So here the solution is 4-3-2-5-1. Means fourth card will come first, then third card, then second card, then fifth card, then first card. So these are the cards which I having. So when I reassembled in this sequence 4-3-2-5-1, then this is the way. When you observe the total string of upper and lower will get similar. For example, upper string is 0-1-1-0-0-1-1-1-0. Again, I am repeating 0-1-1-0-0-1-1-1-0. When you observe the lower part also, 0-1-1-0-0-1-1-1-0. So both are having same. So this is about post correspondence problem. So, and here I am providing the notes which contains some other examples also. And this is about the fifth unit, so which we covered. And today I will post the notes also related to this one. And I am providing some more examples on Turing machine also. Okay, so up to now the syllabus is completed. And still if you required any other topics, then we'll discuss. And if time permits, we'll go with the previous question papers also. So we'll discuss previous question papers also. So I will go through on that one, and we'll find the problems which are not discussed in our class and which came in exams. Okay. And you are having online test also. We'll share the details. Okay. Thank you.